on this beautiful Sunday morning. A little bit warmer than last week. A little less snow. I'm hoping we don't have any more snow until December now, but not going to hold my breath. So, couple of announcements before we begin our worship service. Bible study this week is at Elisa Center, 2 o'clock. So come join us. Folks there always ask lots of really good questions that I don't have answers to, or not easy answers, you know. Simple questions like, what happens when you die? What about the rapture? What about Holy Communion? Is there a hell, and what does it look like? Yeah, easy stuff. So, I always have a good time. So please join us if you're available this Wednesday at 2 o'clock for that at the Elisa Center. Council meeting, not this Monday, but next Monday, coming up. I think, is it 6? So not this Monday, but next Monday. Also, cleanup is on Saturday, May 11th, and we still need 2 lay members for Synod Assembly, so voting members for the 17th and 18th of May, and that has to be submitted by next week. So next Sunday is the cutoff. So if you are interested and available in being one of our voting members, 2 days in Oshkosh, a day and a half, really. So lots of really fun folks to hang out with. Like, if you think your pastor's cool, these people are even cooler than that. If you're interested in voting, even if you're like, I don't know what we're voting on, or I don't know if I'm going to be any good at it, just, talk to me, and I started out doing that, so I didn't know anything, and, church didn't explode or implode for my votes, so, also, just some prayers for the community. Belinda got some prayers for healing. For Jim there, he talked back to the wrong person. I'm told he tripped over an electrical wire. He's a scrapper, so I wouldn't be surprised if that's not the clean version of what he's telling everyone. So. And lastly, today is a special day because we get to celebrate baptism with Sophie. So please pray for and give thanks to Sophie and her family for bringing her to the waters of baptism this morning. So, any other announcements before we begin? Not. I invite you to rise as you are able to our opening prayer for confession and forgiveness. Our service begins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So we take a moment to contemplate that sin in our lives. Most merciful God,
We confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. As called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please join me in singing our gathering song, God is Here, number 719, in our With One Voice little paperback blue handles. 719. It's also on our screens.
Thank you.
unity found in the great Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Please join me in praying together our prayer of the day. Almighty God, with joy we celebrate the festival of our Lord's resurrection.
Graciously help us to show the power of the resurrection in all that we say and do. Through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
May be seated for our readings.
First book comes from Acts chapter 4, verses 32 to 35. This is one of my favorite chapters, lessons. It talks about sharing in our native culture. Way back in, ancestors shared whether they were all fat or whether they were all skinny, whether they were all poor or were they all rich. They treated everyone equally. Okay, now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions. But everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm this morning, Psalm 133. We'll read it by whole verse. Parish reads the verses. Oh, how good and pleasant it is when brethren live together in unity.
It is like fine oil upon the head, and runs down upon the beard.
Upon the beard of Aaron, and runs down upon the collar of his robe.
It is like the dew of Hermon that falls upon the hills of Zion.
For there the Lord has ordained the blessing, live life forevermore.
The second reading is from the New Testament of 1 John. We declare to you what was from the beginning and what we have heard. What we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands. Concerning the word of life, this life was revealed. And we have seen it and it testified to it. Declare to you the eternal life that was with the Father and was revealed to us. We declare to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. But if we walk in the light, as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. My little children, I am writing these things to you that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous, and he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not for ours only, but for also the sins of the whole world. This ends the reading.
Thanks be to God.
I invite the congregation to rise at his table for our gospel confirmation. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who is called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Now, Thomas, Thomas. You know, Thomas gets a really bad rap in the Bible, and certainly within the church. So many people, when you say, remember that a disciple of Jesus, his name was Thomas, they, oh yeah, Doubting Thomas. Come on, really? In our gospel reading this morning, we also have another thing that he was well known as, was Thomas the twin. And his twin wasn't one of the disciples, but that was important for everyone to know that Thomas is a twin. He's one half of a whole. Honestly, why can't Thomas just be Thomas, the disciple? Thomas the discerner. Thomas the disciple who has really great questions that we all want answered, but are too afraid to ask. See, when Jesus gets a little high and theological for the disciples, often it's Thomas that asks the clarifying questions. When Jesus said that he had to die and that he was going ahead with his Father and that everyone would join him, Thomas is the one that said, Jesus, hold up. Where the heck are you going? How are we supposed to follow you? We don't know where you're going to. Are you going to Galilee? Bethlehem? Give us a direction on the compass, at least. Jesus, help the disciple out. But oh, the church has decided to label Thomas as the doubter. The one who, did not have enough faith to believe without proof. And yet, in our gospel reading, Thomas isn't asking for anything that the other disciples hadn't already received. When our story begins, Mary Magdalene and the other women had returned from the tomb, had told the disciples, Jesus, and that guy that we saw die on the cross 3 days ago, he ain't there no more. He's gone. He's resurrected. And yet, where does our gospel find these disciples? Locked away inside for fear of the Jews. If they truly believed this good news, wouldn't they be out there looking for Jesus? Looking to where Jesus had wound up because he wasn't in that grave anymore. Thanks to Thomas, they knew that Jesus was headed to his Father's house. What does that mean for them? What does that mean for us? I remember when I first started seminary and I shared my faith story, my call to ministry, which I still am self-conscious about because it was Christmas Eve. And I'm like, come on, really? Talk about stereotypical call story, like the biggest worship service of the year, other than Easter. And you feel God's presence in the room with you. Wow, that's shocking. So, as I'm sharing this story and feeling self-conscious, I'm like, man, I'm supposed to lead a church? I don't even feel good enough about my own call story. A gentleman from my home congregation, who is old enough to be my father, and then some, shared with me, lamented, that he is still waiting for that experience. Told me that he's gone on retreats, he's been in sweat lodges, he's gone on mission quests, he's gone through fasting for long periods, went in a saltwater chamber, all to try and hear the voice of God speaking to him. He said, Paul, I never heard that voice. Still waiting for that certainty of faith. And it struck me that we all struggle with moments like that. We all struggle with what to do with our doubts and our fears. We see one possibility with the disciples. Let the fear overwhelm us and lock ourselves away, afraid of what might happen. And I get that fear. Because something, even 7 years into ministry, that I still struggle with is that fear that I'm going to visit someone's house and they're going to call me out on it. You're a fraud. You're not really called to lead this church. You don't really believe in all this stuff. You don't belong following Jesus. Now the reason that fear remains is because for so long I heard that voice, outside and within. Too sinful, too absent-minded, too weak. You don't deserve God's love. That fear grows inside you, envelops the faith that you do have and freezes you from acting. So many times in the Bible, we hear angels appear. And people are terrified. They're afraid. They should be. This is an angel of the Lord. Usually they show up to smite people, or to give bad omens, to condemn a town, a country, the whole world. Angels are not like the precious moment figurines. They're terrifying. And yet so often in the gospel we hear the angels saying, oh, don't be afraid. Don't worry. I come with good news. Yeah, that makes it all better. No. They're still afraid. We see the disciples, a week later, they're back in the same place. Maybe less fearful, but still stuck. Only now they have Thomas. And Jesus doesn't do what the angels do. He doesn't say, oh, don't be afraid. It's going to be okay. There's no evil in the world. Jesus doesn't try to tell them that they're wrong for being afraid. Instead, he offers them peace. Peace be with you in the midst of your fears. And peace of God be with you in your doubts. He offers his hands and his side to Thomas. He says, if this is what you need for your faith, then have it. Blessed are those who don't have this and still believe. Peace. Not the absolution of fear. It doesn't erase it. It just accompanies that fear. A allows the disciples and us to act on that faith, to listen to that fear, and then to act anyways. A story I heard and loved was of a little girl out swimming, and she goes up on a diving board. And her instructor is there waiting for her to jump. And as she looks down, she's terrified. And she says, "I can't jump." And her instructor assures her, "It's okay, it's okay. I'll catch you. Jump." And she says, "But I'm afraid." And an elderly woman who is doing laps there looks at this young girl and says, "Then be afraid and do it anyways." And she jumps. And her instructor catches her. That is the peace that Jesus offers to us. Not a faith that destroys any possibility of doubt or fear, but a faith that is great enough to override it, to allow us to act in love towards our neighbors, to give thanks to God for all that we have received and continue to receive. A peace to be shared with others, to overcome our fears and our doubts. So let us say yes to Jesus when he calls. Peace be with you. Amen.
Amen.
And now let us sing together our hymn of the day, a communion hymn, which is great. If you listen to the lyrics, as you sing it, really great words. Same hymnal, number 711, "You Satisfy the Hungry Heart." And since this was one that I wasn't too familiar with, I've sang it a couple times, I found a version where we can sing along with other people. So, even if we're not singing, those people online, we're going to sing it. But if you're afraid, peace be with you, and you can sing along with other folks. Let us sing 711, "You Satisfy the Hungry Heart."
Thank you.
time, I invite Sophie and her family to come forward for her baptism.
All right. Probably do me and Sophie.
In holy baptism, our gracious Heavenly Father liberates us from sin and death by joining us to the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. We are born children of a fallen humanity. In the waters of baptism, we are reborn children of God and inheritors of eternal life. By water and the Holy Spirit, we are made members of the Church, which is the body of Christ. As we live with him and with his people, we grow in faith, love, and obedience to the will of God. So I ask Sophie's sponsors to present her.
I present Sophie Berkus Roberts to receive the sacrament of holy baptism.
In Christian love, you have presented this child for holy baptism. You should therefore faithfully bring her to the services of God's house, teach her the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, and the Ten Commandments. As she grows in years, you should introduce her to the Holy Scriptures and provide for her instruction in the Christian faith, that living in the covenant of her baptism and in communion with the Church, she may lead a godly life until the day of Jesus Christ. Sponsors, do you promise to fulfill these obligations?
We do.
I don't know what I would do if they said no, but someday it's going to happen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
All right, and for any children that are here, I invite you to come forward. You need to activate the waters of baptism.
We're not children.
You have a big job.
So, I'm going to stir this on off. You want to pour a little bit?
Careful.
At a time. Holy God, mighty Lord, gracious Father, we give you thanks. From the beginning, your Spirit moved over the waters, and you created heaven and earth. By the gift of water, you nourish and sustain us and all living things. By the waters of the flood, you condemned the wicked and saved those whom you had chosen, Noah and his family. You led Israel by the pillar of cloud and fire through the sea and out of slavery into the freedom of the promised land. In the waters of the Jordan, your son was baptized by John and anointed with the Spirit. By the baptism of his own death and resurrection, your beloved son has set us free from the bondage to sin and death and has opened the way to the joy and freedom of everlasting life. He made water a sign of the kingdom and of cleansing and rebirth. In obedience to his command, we make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Pour out your Holy Spirit so that those who are here baptized may be given new life. Wash away the sin of all those who are cleansed by this water, and bring them forth as inheritors of your glorious kingdom. To you be given praise and honor and worship through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. In the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Good job. All right, so sponsors, and the rest of the congregation if you'd like to join as well. I ask you to profess your faith in Christ Jesus, reject sin, and confess the faith of the Church, the faith in which we baptize. To renounce all the forces of evil, the devil, and all his empty promises.
I do.
Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, the life everlasting. Amen.
All right, so having confessed our faith, Sophie, I mean Marcus Roberts, I baptize you in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we give you thanks for freeing your sons and daughters from the power of sin and for raising them up to new life through this holy sacrament. Pour your Holy Spirit upon Sophie, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence.
Amen.
All right, so we've got oil that have been blessed for the anointing. We've got pomegranate. It smells really good. So after service, everyone came out and sniffed it. No, just all right, go. Sophie Irene Mercus Roberts, child of God, you have been sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked for the cross of Christ forever.
Amen.
And then, because oil isn't enough, we have fire. I'll give this to one of the sponsors. Responsible adult. Bring it in. Let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. We give this candle as a remembrance of this day. So on the 1 year and annual anniversary of this baptism, I invite you to share with Sophie the events of this day, and to celebrate in a new life in Jesus Christ. So you can light it on the anniversary or whenever you discuss baptism. O God, the giver of all life, look with kindness upon the guardian and godparents of this child. Let them ever rejoice in the gift you have given them. Make them teachers and examples of righteousness for her. Strengthen them in their own baptism, so they may share eternally with Sophie the salvation you have given them through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
So congregation, through baptism, God has made this new sister a member of the priesthood we all share in Christ Jesus, that we may proclaim the praise of God and bear his creative and redeeming word to all the world.
We welcome you into the Lord's hand. We receive you as fellow members of the body of Christ, children of the same Heavenly Father, and workers of us in the kingdom of our God.
All right. So, I invite everyone to give thanks to Sophie. One applause. We extinguish the candle too. And I do have the baptismal certificate with space for both sponsors to sign. And then each sponsor also has a certificate that you sponsored. So if you want to sign yours, I've tried before to hand them off and give them to the right people, and I always mix it up. So a little easier to do, but so yeah. Sign those, whatever.
Okay.
So you may return to your seats.
Don't be.
We continue with the peace. So the peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share that peace with those around you. Let us pray. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, maker of all things. Through your goodness you have blessed us with these gifts. With them we offer ourselves to your service and dedicate our lives to the care and redemption of all that you have made, for the sake of him who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Sing it together, our dogs out. Chiefly, we are bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of our Lord, for he is the true Passover Lamb, who gave himself to take away our sin, who by his death has destroyed death, and by his rising has brought us to eternal life. And so, with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
O God, in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, blessed it, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gather. gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Let us pray as our Lord taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
People of God, this is God's table, and there is a place for you here. Communion at Wilderness is open to all who believe. This is not restricted to those that I feel worthy, or Wilderness, or the ELCA. This is God's table. So, for those receiving, you'll receive a wafer, and then grape juice. There's no wine. And then return to your pews. For those that would rather remain in their seats, we also have the fellowship cups back by the bulletins that you can use instead. So, come to the banquet, for all is now ready.
Yeah.
and rise as you are able. Almighty God, you gave your Son both as a sacrifice for sin and a model of the godly life. Enable us to receive him always with thanksgiving and to conform our lives to his, through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Receive this thanksgiving. May Patimaras bless you and keep you. May Patimaras shine on you and be gracious to you. May Patimaras look upon you with favor and grant you peace.
In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Spirit that makes us one. Amen and amen.
Our Sunday hymn is in our wilderness hymnals, the blue or wood hardcover binders, number 25, He Lives, and I Serve the Risen Savior, number 25.
Yeah.